great privilege and a unique opportunity today to listen to Bruce also. And we will spend the first 40 minutes listening to him. And then we will continue another 30, 40 minutes after that with questions and maybe something he would like to add to the first part. I know that some of you have only classes this first period, so it's voluntary, the second one, but the voluntary work is more worth than what we are obliged to do. So I mean, if you want to stay, you're most welcome. Welcome, Bruce. It's so good to have you here with us. So I hand over to you immediately, yes? Shall we give him a...
About the pictures you changed.
Yeah, I can change that. Yeah, let me just say that we have three books that talk about the work that Bruce has been involved in. The first one came out in the 70s, Driven av kärlek, in Swedish. This, I think, is the third edition or something like that. The history was fantastic, what God was doing. So they had to send a journalist down to Colombia to see if it was true. And then the second book came out, written by Andres King, a journalist, that could confirm what Bruce had told in this first book. And then a few years ago, 2007, we received the second book written by Bruce, The Miracle Among the Motilons, Miracle bland Motilona. So if you haven't read them, don't think that everything that he will say today is I mean, he will not have time to say everything that is in the books, so you need to read the books as well.
Bruce. Well, thank you. This is quite a change from the jungles of South America. There I'm protected, secluded in the jungles. Now I have left South America, and after traveling for 14 hours, arrive in Europe, a sophisticated continent. Are you going to manage pictures? Do you want commentaries on the pictures, or I can just talk and you can show pictures?
Yeah, we'll show the pictures.
Yeah. If you have a special question, I can answer perhaps. You can see that the native peoples among whom I work are isolated from contact with the Western world. They have their own society, speak their own unique language, and they consider the outside people, us, that we are cannibals. We have a magical flute and that hums over the mountain range in the yesteryears. And civilized people would come out from behind trees and grab their flesh. This is a Motilon communal home. Civilized people would come out from behind the trees and cut the flesh of the natives, and the blood that would drip to the ground they would paint on the side of the magical flute. Now generations pass and a DC-3 airplane flies over the territory. That's the personification of the magical flute. And the red letters that says Petroleum Company on the side of the flute is the blood of their deceased relatives. This is the construction of Motilon communal home. The house will be at least 15 meters in height by 40 meters long by 35 meters wide. It's a shape, oblong shape. It's constructed out of palm materials, poles. The poles are pulled together to a central beam. This is the interior of the house where the women cook the roots during the evening hours and the breakfast foods. This is a mandioc root that she's grinding on tree bark that will stuff into banana leaves and roast in the fire. It's very succulent and delicious. And the traditional way of sleep is in chinchorros or hammocks. The youth have their hammocks in the higher rafters of the home. Here they're gathering together rocks and leaves to build a dam to dry a portion of the river where they can go in with spears to fish. The children have their bows and arrows shooting at fish in some of the natural pools of water that have been left after damming the river. The mother is weaving a round loom. She has a wild turkey chick on her leg, and the stripes in the dress she calls the headwaters of the river systems. Here she is using her toe quite efficiently, weaving a hat for her husband. It is round and is placed on top of the head, and the hair is pulled through the hole. This young girl is dressed in beautiful jewelry. These are telephone lines cut down from the oil company's communications. Red, greens, and blues, and make beautiful necklaces. Here, these are the leaves that are being applied between the rushing waters and of the dam that they're building to fish. That's a photo of me one time. This is Arrabadoito, one of the chieftains who has spoken with the president of Colombia. Yeah, well, that's enough photos. I think that have helped give you an environment, perhaps, to what we're speaking about. Otherwise, I think we'll lose much time in commentaries on the other photos. So I hope to bring you into the jungles to give you an environment that's very different from the West. I have lived there for 57 years. So when I come to Sweden, I say, what language would you like to speak in? I say, well, I'll speak in buddy language first. No, there's no translator in buddy language. Okay, well, then we'll go to Yukpa. No, there's no translator in the Yukpa language. These are the languages that I am most efficient in. So we go to Spanish. Ah, but people don't speak Spanish very well in Sweden. However, I've met many Spanish-speaking people. English would be the language of choice. And that's the language I'm least fluent in. So with the insecure feeling of leaving the jungles of South America to come to North America here, Sweden, it's uncomforting. I struggle to recover my English, and I think I'm doing maybe all right. Over the past 57 years, I learned to speak 14 languages. And I went to South America with a two-word vocabulary in Spanish, which is adios, amigo. I had studied Hebrew. I had 4 years of Hebrew school, Talmud Torah Hebrew school. I had 4 years of classical Greek, a year and a half of Koine Greek, and 4 years of Latin. I wanted to work in archival sciences. That's working original manuscripts. I had a scholarship to go to Tel Aviv University, which had thrilled me. It was my goal in life. And then God challenges me, what are my priorities in your life? I've never thought that God would have priorities in my life. I mean, I was born to Scandinavian parents. You do what you want to do. That's your freedom. I'm going to go to Tel Aviv University. But God's challenge was, what would I do with your life? Reading the scriptures, Paul says, in all of life's experience, he wants to be conformed to the image of Christ, even if it be through death. Paul had a deep spiritual relationship with Christ. I don't understand that. I didn't understand that Christ, when he resurrected and ascended to heaven, he said, I must go so the Holy Spirit can come and live with you. How does the Holy Spirit live with me? In your heart. Apostle Paul says when we believe that God is incarnate in Christ, that his blood was shed to forgive our sins, and we believe in his resurrection, that we are made new creations, new creatures. We are born anew, a spiritual birth. Now scriptures are telling me that Christ ascended to heaven so the Holy Spirit can live in our midst. Christ can just be with one person at a time while he walked the surface of the earth. But the Holy Spirit can be in all the hearts of the believers whom Paul says are new creatures in Christ Jesus. So the challenge that God put in my heart, find what I would have you do with your life. I would mature with that idea. And I'd share with my friends. And I gave up the idea of going to Tel Aviv, if that would not be God's pattern in my life. And I had a peace in my heart that I'd made a decision to be as honest as I can with my Creator. That's when God challenged me to bring the gospel to people who had never heard of Jesus Christ before in the 20th, 21st century. My friend said, it's ridiculous. You don't speak Spanish, you don't speak Portuguese, and you're thinking of going to South America. And it was when I was 17, before my 18th birthday, I got the visa for South America, took an international flight to Maicatia, the coastal area of Venezuela. Disembarked from the flight, it was 40 degrees above Celsius, above zero, and I had left Minneapolis, Minnesota 40 degrees below zero. What a contrast. The vapors just feel like they're crushing my body. I knew nobody. And I recall in the hotel room I'd written my diary, I have innocently come this far with God's instruction in my life. I know nobody in Venezuela. What's going to happen next? To answer that question, I shared it last night, I'll repeat it right now. I left the hotel and walked the beaches of Macuto, and I heard the children speaking in Spanish, and I could use my two-word vocabulary when they would approach me as a foreigner. Adios amigo, and they'd leave me alone. That means goodbye friend. Later on in the day, contemporaries about my own age approached me, and I said to them in fright, adios amigo, leave me alone. Goodbye, friend. They said, no. They'd use their English with me. What are you doing? I said, nothing. Where are you going? I said, nowhere. That's what we are doing. You can do that with us. So it was my contemporaries that took me under their wings and brought me to their boarding home where I would learn proper Spanish. I would never learn Hebrew or Greek or Latin in South America. These are not important languages. But what will the importance of these languages be? Years later, I'm translating the New Testament into four languages. What do we translate from? Paraphrased New Testament in English? Or a controversial translation of the Swedish New Testament? No, we go back to the Koine Greek. Well, I'm with the Motilung people, learning their language, and I discover it's a tonal language. You say, Brokba. That means stone axe. Brokba, that means banana. It took me 2 weeks to learn that difference. I'm supposed to be a linguist. Their language is exciting. If I invite you to their territory, it sounds like this. A tonal language. Did God really create that language? Not only did he create the language, he gave the Motilones their conscience. And he placed the Motilones in the isolated jungles that they have protected since the first discovery of their territories 500 years ago by Alonso de Ojeda. 500 years later, I will venture into their territories. The same people. They haven't seen a wheel before. They haven't seen glass. I was captured by the tribal peoples. They're amazed that I can speak an intelligible language. My first words was copying what they were saying to me. Berg babadi, berg babadi. That brought laughter and comedy among them. Then they found out that I have a personality, but I'm not intelligible. They pulled off my shirt and found my body had no coloration. And then the women commented, our husbands captured a cannibal, and they brought him home. So in one sense of the word, part of the community was frightened by this outsider. And in another sense, some of the warriors were intrigued that I could be tall, without coloration, and couldn't speak an intelligible language. To the Motilone, language is life. Every Motilone word and name ends in A because you possess life. What about that fellow we have here whom we call the cannibal? But since I was alone by myself, they didn't think that I was a total danger for them. And they put up with me and I would start learning basic vocabularies. They delight in monkey entrails with the natural stuffings. So you can use your imagination what that is. It's half-digested food. Ah, but it's fermented, like surströmming in North Sweden. Or like oysters on the New York coast. Gray, slippery things that people eat alive. Well, we have surströmming encased in monkey entrails. But when I learn the word for banana, brokba, my hunger is satisfied. I've come to the jungles to help the Indians. How can I help them? The Organization of American States had sponsored a conference on community development. And the former president of Colombia was the moderator of this conference. He had a relative who worked for the Shell Oil Company. They had sent a commission into Motilon territory to make a geological survey. And the survey was ambushed by warring Indians, short, color of the pineapple, and they said short hair. All the other Indians in South America, in contrast, had long hair. So they called this tribe the Motilons, people of short hair, where they call themselves Bari, that means us, the people. The president decided he would invite some Motilons to this conference of community development. Indians in South America, especially Colombia, were considered minors, not of age. You cannot own properties because you're a minor. The government should protect the Indians, but wherever Indians live, that's called homesteading territories. So displaced people from cities can carve farms out of the jungles where Indians live, and the Indians must recede further into jungle areas. The Motilons, however, the Colombian paper said, were arrogant. They didn't accept the oil company's expeditions to look for mineral resources. Neither would they admit the colonization to their territories to carve down the jungles and establish farms. And the Motilons were considered outlaws. But there's something in the pride of the Latin American there, tribal peoples who had never been conquered before. The Spaniards could not subjugate them to their rule. Neither could the modern government of today subjugate them to Colombian dominance. And I felt in my heart a pride, proud of the Motilon people who have protected these territories and trusted to them. Now I'm living with the Motilons. I'm going to bring great knowledge of the Western world. What happens? My clothes rot. I'm naked. That can be embarrassing, but to a young teenager it can be challenging as well. Run through the jungles free of impediments and clothing, and the mosquitoes are delighted. Fresh blood from a new continent. So the Motilons dressed me in a loincloth. I'm hungry, and they feed me. And then the Rabadoike said, finally, he learned an intelligible language. I invited you to Motilon territory, an exotic tonal language. The New Testament is now translated into this language. It didn't happen overnight. It took 40-some years. Contact with the Motilon people. Didn't just walk in as an ambassador and present credentials. I was shot with an arrow and captured by the Motilon tribe. So my first 7 years, they're gracious and care for me. You see 200 people living under one roof, and I see no social contention, no fights, no intoxicating beverages. I see no drug usage. I see tribal understanding among members of the community. And I think in my heart, why should a missionary come here? The reason I'm a missionary is because I know the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the vacuum I had in my heart, the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, it lives in this heart and stops that vacuum. I know my Creator. I know my Savior. This is what I want to share with the Motilons. Great. That's noteworthy. But you just learned the difference between banana and axe. Now, the president of Colombia is a monitor for the Congress of Community Development. A relative of his was with a Shell Commission making a geological inventory of the Catatumbo territories. He was shot with a Motilon arrow. The president realized that a Scandinavian American had been living with the tribal peoples. This is 40 years later. And he has seen medical doctors from the Motilon community graduated from local universities. 50. He had met some of the lawyers from the Motilon community, photos that you had seen here this afternoon, who are graduated lawyers from St. Thomas University, one of the finest law schools in South America. And he was thinking, well, this is community development. Stone Age Indians making one generation step into the modern times. So he invited a delegation of Multilomes to attend the Organization of American States Congress. We had ambassadors from Canada, United States, Central America, and South America. And Araba Doika would put on breeches, a pair of slacks over his loincloth. He'd put on a plaid shirt. It looked like any Scandinavian youth in his attire. Squeezed his toes into a pair of tennis shoes. Walked very clumsily, but would come to this conference, as would Chamarravi, one of our first graduated medical doctors. But Chamarravi will not speak to the delegation. It will be Araba Doika, because he's a chieftain. He has a tribal respect. The president inquires of Araba Doika, what has changed your people? And Araba Doika is a poet. He says, we walk a trail that brings us towards the horizon. God lives in the horizon. We once knew him, but we left the abode of God. In the jungles, there are many trails. All animals have their trails. Our leaders have trails. And there's one trail that will bring us back to the horizon. We walk on that trail. We found it. The president is intrigued with this poetry that he's sharing with this Congress and community development. So the first person on the trail is a chieftain. You walk in the footsteps of the chieftain. You're following the chieftain. That's beautiful. So the chieftain must be the missionary Bruce Olson. And he said, no. When he was naked, we clothed him. When he was hungry, we fed him, and we taught him an intelligible language. We don't follow in his footsteps. That's not good for us. So the president thinks, well, that trail must be symbolic of preventative medical procedures by which they have stopped epidemic diseases decimating the population. Perhaps it's the art of tropical agriculture. This must be the after which you're walking this new trail. And the Araba Doika says, no. Those are new tools that we have, that we harvested from you, the outside world, that we've incorporated into our system of values so we can forge our own future, not being humiliated to be begging to someone. Oh, so if your Olsons are no good to you, these tools don't guarantee your struggle towards the horizon. In whose footsteps do you walk? And the Araba Doika says, we walk in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. How can Jesus Christ be real to an Indian who has never seen a wheel before, has never seen glass, has never seen a transistor radio? When we sent our missionaries to Africa, the African who lived in round buildings, indicative of eternity, holiness, no beginning nor end, something of God's character. We taught them to live in square buildings like we have in Europe. And we think as the African becomes more oriented due to the culture of the European, he's going to come closer to God so they can understand the Jesus whom we worship. And we're converting the African to a Western God, not to the Creator who has so tempted and tried us, each African. I've seen it in South America. Mission organizations have contacted tribal peoples, opening up their lands to colonization. Is that a positive result of the gospel? Diseases that are brought into indigenous territories that they have no resistance against will convert into epidemics and decimate the populations of the people. This is an unwanted thing from civilization. But oftentimes the church is a pioneering church to preach the gospel, recklessly go to tribal areas and expose them to these negative contacts with the outside world. Here is the Multilone Nation, who 40 years ago knew nothing of the market economy. Today they have 48 cooperatives selling chocolate on the market, profits of which sustain 90% of the expenses of their health centers and schools. This is one tribal people who come in dialogue with the Western world who have not been converted into beggars. You destroy a person's culture, community culture, you convert them into beggars. I recall in one instance in Ecuador, a missionary came with his antibiotics and challenged the medicine man. the medicine men doing incantations and prayers, the people continued to be sick. So the missionary said, I can cure them with our medications. And the medications were provided by evangelical churches, and the missionary cured the sick. So what happened? The witch doctor is upset about this. Greater competition. If the witch doctor capitulates, what happens? He relinquishes his power, and the structure of the people starts to disintegrate. Is the disintegration of the tribal organization bringing them to Christ? Is the absence of a medicine man or a witch doctor bringing people to Christ? You mean you're saying the gospel is the absence of a medicine man? It's not true. You can destroy their social organization. Now, are you happy? Now, will they emulate Jesus? Paul says not. So if the witch doctor, what should I say? Rather than competing, he will eliminate the competition. What would you call that? A missionary martyr. Missionary is dead because he came against the witch doctor. Is he a martyr for the cause of Christ or for his own stupidity? This is important because we're moving into new cultures, new expressions, new system of values. As Christians, we get confused. We have to build a square church. Well, the Motilones count to three. One, two, three. Do they meet on Sunday? No, they don't know that Sunday exists. Well, they have birthdays. They don't have birthdays. They count to three. Well, how do they know when to celebrate Christmas? We don't have Christmas. Every day, Jesus is in our heart. Well, how do you worship once a week? Don't worship God 6 days a week. No, life is integral. It's integrated. Everything that we do is prayer, is worship, the hunt, the harvesting of the natural roots from the jungle floor. I'm with Oktavidaina, and finally we're stalking a deer. He pulls back his metal-tipped arrow. The tip was a trophy that he won in confrontation with the oil company. Now he filed that down on rocks into a metal-tipped arrow and is ready to shoot the deer. But before he shoots the deer, he says, Spirit of the hunt, I need your flesh to nourish my family. What did the deer do? You make a wild guess. Ran away. Escaped. And I was disappointed. I was already had venison. We persevered and once again stalked the deer. And for the second time, Oktavidaina said, Spirit of the hunt, I need your flesh to nourish my family. And the deer stayed still. And Oktavidaina shot the deer. And as he opened the deer up, said, Thanks to God, my family will be full. Barriga llena, corazón contento. Full stomach is a happy heart. Aishabishuk sudari in the Motilone language. A reverence to the creation about them. Paul says in Romans that God's creation reflects something of his character to us as we live in harmony with the ecology, and the Motilones live in harmony with their ecology, respect to the animals, the spirits that they hear whispering in the winds. I don't understand those spirits, but you're just learning their language. So the president is reflecting that his brother-in-law was shot by the Motilones. Now they've produced doctors from that environment. They've produced lawyers who are articulating legislation rather than shooting against the land settlers. Motilones are in dialogue with the Western world. They're becoming globalized, acculturated. Is that good or not? But Arabadueca says to the president, what changed us is walking the steps of Jesus. How does a Motilone in the jungles walk in the steps of Jesus? How does he come into contact with the market economy and not abandon the territories? 50 graduated physicians from Colombian universities, not one has abandoned the jungles for preference of city life. Lawyers who are articulating legislation, championing the protection of indigenous territories, not one has abandoned the jungle for preference of city life. Why? They met Jesus in the jungles. They're committed to his claims on their life, and they are committed to the respective communities. So the Motilons know Jesus. How does that happen? Rather than being an enemy with the medicine men, I worked with them. There's an epidemic, a conjunctivitis. And the medicine men would sing songs to heal the aching, swollen eyes. I told the medicine man, I have terramycin, you put this in the people's eyes. He said, we don't use your magic, you're from the outside world. So I rubbed my fingers into the eyes of a sick Motilon and contaminated my own eyes. And the medicine man would sing for me songs of healing, but my eyes did not improve. I reasoned with him. Since I'm from the outside world, you can put terramycin in my eyes and give me a new song of healing. And he took that combination and did it and cured my eyes in 3 days. He knew it was that new song of healing that was so effective. And so he took that new song to everyone else who had sick eyes, but no one's eyes improved. One evening he asked me, do I have more tubes of terramycin? And I said, I do. He took the tubes of terramycin, squeezed it into everybody's eyes, and then sang for them a new song of healing and cured their eyes in 3 days. He knew it was that new song of healing. Yeah, and he wanted more tubes of terramycin. And I gave him. In the jungles, there's a change of wet season to dry season and vice versa. During this change, seasonal change, there's no hunt because the animals have migrated. The waters are turbulent, you can't fish with a spear. The natural fruits of the jungles are barren and the roots are bitter. And there are 3 months every year when they go through hunger periods. Children will have bloated stomachs because of lack of protein, infestation of parasites. I got this idea. We'll plant seeds. These are semi-nomadic people, jungle wanderers. They had never grown crops before. And so I had corn. And we planted some seeds of corn, myself and the chieftain. And the corn grew. And when the cobs broke on the side of the plant, he bit into the corn cob and found it sweet and succulent. The skin around the kernel lodged in the back of his throat and caused him to cough. And he told his followers, we're going to plant cough. They thought he was crazy, but he is their chief. So they planted the first kernels of corn. Then they planted rice and beans. And for the first time, the Motilon community had a surplus of foods. When there's a seasonal change from wet season to dry season, they had dried corn they could grind into patties. They had beans and rice that they could cook and steam. Their stomachs were full. Our tribal chieftains are good leaders. Now the leaders are closer to me as I'm bonding with them, not in competition against their authority, but cooperating and moving with them. That's good politics. It's logical. It's building what we have in common. I've heard oftentimes the State Department sends ambassadors to other countries to resolve problems that don't exist. The church has resolved problems that don't exist as well. We have to learn to communicate, not to go against the tribal organization, but flow with it. Build what we have in common for better understanding and bond with the leaders and start sharing with me their idea of the universe. God lives beyond the horizon. Beautiful concept. We struggle to attain the horizon, and the further we walk, the further away the horizon is from us. Ah, but there are many trails in the jungles. And there's one trail that'll bring us to the horizon. I was watching ants building an anthill. It's identical to a Motilon community house, but all in the miniature. It took the intelligence of the Motilon, who knows how to make a community house, to teach the ants community life. How did that happen? A warrior was incarnate into an ant. What a challenge. What a word. After 7 years, incarnate, a precious word. I arrived at the home of a Chirinda Kaido, wherein a tribal leader had died, and the youth had climbed into the jungle canopy, eating the unfolding leaves of the tree, shouting the horizon, God, reveal yourself to us. Other tribal members had carved a hole into the jungle floor, shouted into that hole, God, come to us. 7 years with the Motilons, I see total harmony in tribal union life. An anthropologist, what do you want the missionary to go there for? You as a missionary say, yes, they're living in the character of God, the reflection of creation that surrounds them. It has taught them how to live in tribal harmony. Isn't that enough? I was born in a Lutheran family. I went to Lutheran Catechism. Isn't that enough? There was a vacuum in my heart. Not until I understood the resurrection of Jesus and His Holy Spirit can live in my heart, where Paul says we're created a new person, did I have peace in my life. Then what I learned from the Lutheran Church meant something to me. The Motilones live in harmony, but there's a hunger in their heart to come back to their Creator. I took this word incarnate, and I said, God is incarnate in Jesus Christ to walk your trail of life's experience. How beautiful. On a trail, you hunt, you harvest the natural roots of the jungle, you have a happy life, you have a fulfilling life, and there's a trail in the jungle that we haven't found yet will bring us to the land of God, the horizon. I said, God is incarnate in Jesus to walk your trail of life's experience. Oh, David, I'm delighted. He grabbed my hand. You know Jesus Christ. I do. And in the 20th, 21st century, he says, take me to meet Jesus in our jungles. Well, that should make any missionary happy. You can teach them theology. You can teach them Koine Greek. You can teach them that snow is white. They've never seen snow before. They don't know what Koine Greek is. It's not fulfilling to them. What's the gospel to the Motilones? God is incarnate in Jesus. Take me to him. I backed off and I said, I cannot. You killed Jesus Christ. And they were convinced he must have been an oil company employee. In whose metal helmet their women were cooking wild turkey eggs. This is the now. I step back. You cannot. You killed Jesus Christ. When they kill a tapir, which is a large animal, looks like a giant pig, it can weigh up to 110 kilos, the medicine man cracks open a wild cane, creating a very sharp knife. And with this knife, he takes the skin or the hide off the tapir. And in a tribal ritual, he pulls that hide over his head and down his back. What does that remind you of? Sacrifice. What did Christ do on the cross? His blood was shed for the remission of our sin. What is the medicine man doing? He's hiding his image from the people. I have become a tapir. Christ became sin for us at his death. So I use this word to pull over the skin, that Christ pulls his shed blood over our deception, their generic word for sin. But Octavidina says, if Jesus is dead, what hope is there for us? We're in dialogue now. We're understanding each other's language. We're speaking contextualized within the anthropology, the linguistics of their ethnicity. Motilones are animists. That means to say spirits live in certain objects. In the rocks, you shout into the cave and it answers back. There's a spirit answering. When the wind whispers through the leaves of the banana plants, there's a combination of tones. Motilone is a tonal language. You don't have to articulate words. You can hum their language and totally understand, communicate well. And sometimes the elders have heard prophecies that something of God's character dynamic will come out of the banana stalk. Now that throws me for confusion. I'm talking about God incarnate in Jesus, his death. And I said to the Motilones, Christ is resurrected. But that can't be. No one comes alive after death. There was a questioning of my intelligence. It doesn't jive with what they have in their traditions. Octavidina says, since you talk of God and we know something of his character, should come to us from the banana stalk. He cut open the trunk of a banana tree and he split it open lengthwise. And the leaves inside were severed in half and fell out like pages from a book. I took my Spanish New Testament. I said, here it says, Jesus is resurrected from the dead. There's authority within their culture. Our old people spoke of the character of God in the banana stalk. Their pages like from a book. they realized that the bird print, you know, when a bird walks in sand, it leaves letters, you know, like our alphabet. It doesn't whisper to my ears, it relates to my eyes, vowels and consonants. They learned that what I write on a piece of paper doesn't change. You have God's banana stock. And I open up, it says, Jesus is resurrected from the dead. This was resounding truth in their hearts. The next day, Bobri Shora said to me, I speak a new language. Cuénteme que hablas otro idioma. How is this you speak another language? He doesn't understand Spanish. If he's going to speak another language other than Motilón, it should be Spanish. But then I think, life is language. Every Motilón name ends in A, because you are a possessor of life. He's saying he has a new life. Yes, Jesus is in my body. The first believer among Motilón people. 7 years in the missionary endeavor. We can't write a prayer or letter back home saying we have so many thousands of converts. One in 7 years. Pretty expensive. Maybe it's not economically viable. Here is a tribe of people that God has protected in the hollow of his hands in the high Catatumbo. And I thought, well, now Bobri Shora will tell everybody of his conversion experience. But he was silent and told me. Every 3 years, great delegations of Motilón people come together for the festivities of the Arrow when they create epic poetry in tone and rhyme. Epic poetry means lengthy poems. And there are some of these poems will go on for 10 hours in length, recitation. Oh, the primitive peoples, you know. They grunt and groan because they don't have a language. They're grunting and groaning because the tonal language, they don't have to waste their time with words. Oh, they have 14 aspects of time. Oh, more complicated in Swedish. More complicated in Koine Greek. They have 15 words for red. Tuktagiura, birai karara, karakashugdura, mamyokba. And there's no common root in these words. Red to an animate object, red to an inanimate object. Red to a flat object that's soft, red to a round object that's hard. That's all part of their language. The children don't speak the language correctly until they're in their late teens. Primitive. And they create poetry. Well, now the Latin Americans like poetry. Arseniegas, he has some beautiful poems. I love his readings. That's why I originally went to Colombia. Like this poetry. Now I hear Motilón's reciting poetry, and they sing it in the low chant, 12 to 14 hours of duration. And Bobri Shora singing in his hammock, there's a trail that goes to the horizon. I walk in the footsteps of Jesus Christ to come to this horizon. And everyone else stops singing to listen to his poem. Then the chieftain comes in behind him, copying his words, and goes on for 12 hours. And the Holy Spirit is bathed upon the Motilón brethren at this meeting of the Arrow. They understood God incarnate in Jesus, his death and resurrection, an atonement for our sin, that we on his trail can come to the horizon and know our Creator. God's Holy Spirit visited this Motilón community. There are evil spirits in the jungles as well. One gentleman asked me, what do I do when I'm confronted by an evil spirit? I do what the deer does when he's confronted with the arrow of Oktabidaina. I run. I circumvent the problem. I said, there's enough problems in the jungles just surviving than to confront evil spirits. Well, I'm not an evangelist and I don't preach against evil spirits. I'm sharing the quality of life with the Motilón people. But the tiger spoke. And when the tiger, I should say jaguar, we say tigre in Spanish, but it actually is a jaguar. Tigers are in Africa. Jaguar spoke and brought an evil prophecy that there'll be death within the community of Corrocaira. Oh, I don't believe tigers or jaguars can talk. You don't, do you? Of course not. Oh, there's no problem. Ha! But the Motilons were frightened. The devils will walk at nighttime and people will die. They didn't care if I believed in that or not. But when Ashoka, the first Christian, came to me, can Jesus be taken from my mouth and I could die? We must sing the songs of incantations to ward off the evil spirits. He came to me for counsel, the best counsel I could give him. You know Jesus. His spirit lives in your heart. And we were separated over the confusion of 200 people lamenting the evening that is coming when the prophecy of the jaguar will take lives out of the community. And when this happens, people die. I had walked into the jungles, and at dusk time, I was returning back to the home of Corro Caida. And I saw the community house. You saw a photograph of it. It was literally swaying back and forth. I thought that was hallucinating. Oh, it must be the evil spirit. The home was rollicking back and forth. But I felt constrained to get close to the home. Then I observed that over 100 warriors were in the hammocks in the rafters of the home, swinging back and forth. That's why the house was swaying. It's built out of palm material. It was swaying with the force of the body weight of the people. And they were singing incantations. The women were on the mats, silhouetted by the fires where they cooked the manioc root in the evening hours. And they had their eyes closed, and they're hitting rocks together, singing incantations to ward off the evil spirit. Other tribal warriors were in their hammocks in the rafters of the home, as I had mentioned, swinging back and forth, singing incantations, but everyone had their eyes closed, so no spirit of the jaguar could come into their body and take their life. And I looked for the first Christian, Bobari Shoda. Where is he? He was swinging back and forth in the hammock, just like everybody else. I thought, what a disappointment. Maybe he never understood the resurrection of Jesus. But I was constrained to get near, close to him. Then I held onto the poles underneath his hammock, started climbing up the side of the community house. And I leaned over his hammock, and I saw his eyes were open, and the fires on the floor level were flickering in his opened eyes. And I strained to hear what he was singing. I'm a Jesus boy. I have his life in my body. I walk on his trail. No evil spirit can destroy me. I believe in his resurrection. And he sang that song the whole evening. He was a born-again Christian of the Spirit of God. He is a Motilon communicating his faith in their own style. He's not singing a simple song from the West, Jesus loves me, this I know. He doesn't go to church on Sunday. He doesn't count beyond three. But he knows the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that evening, no one died in that community house. Bobari Shoda confronted the evil spirit. Now there are several Christians among the Motilon people. We come together as the body of Christ to stop the onslaughts of the evil spirits. As a missionary, I will not stop the evil spirits by my own authority as one individual, but as a community with the witness of the Holy Spirit in our hearts that this territory no longer pertains to the devil and separation from God, the Motilons have strength over the evil spirits that they had so feared. Well, the anthropologist Lars Persson says, oh, well, that's good. The Motilons have now agriculture, preventative medical procedures. They have graduated some professional personnel from universities. However, what's going to happen to their territories? What's going to happen to the perseverance of traditional lifestyle? And he would make a criticism that missionaries have pioneered opening up indigenous territories to colonization. And he created a good scandal here in Sweden about Bruce Olsen and life among the Motilons. I never wanted to go public about life among the Motilons. That was not my reason going to South America. And when I was entertained that I should publish a book, I didn't like the idea. But the publishers convinced me that perhaps it could be a challenge to young people who are thinking of mission and involvement in third world countries. So the book is published, and Lars Persson makes his accusations. And Andres Kung will come to Colombia to investigate Olsen. I was to leave Colombia for a conference in New York on Bible translations. I finished the translation of the New Testament contextualized within the Motilon culture and language, and I was so happy for the translation. And I was going on consultation with Eugene Nida in New York. But Andres Kuhn came. He said, I'm the great journalist. I said, good for you. Have a good time. I'm going to New York. No, you must go with me. The publisher have commissioned me to investigate you. I said, that's another good reason for me not to be here. But he backed me into a corner and I stayed. He said, I must go into Motilon territory. And he said, by the way, I want you to know I'm an atheist. I'm anti-mission. I have nothing to do with the church. What a friend is coming to visit me. As if we don't have enough devils in the jungles. So, okay, I canceled my trip to New York, which I think was providential from God. And Andres King prepared his backpack and we walked into the jungles. He said, where are we going? I said, we're going to Shubakbarina. Oh, I can't even say that word. Write it down for me. Shubakbarina. Okay, that's good. How long to get there? I said, 3 days. Oh, that's not bad. The first day, we covered 1/4, which you generally do in a day of hiking. The second day, 1/8 of what you generally do in hiking. He said, well, that's almost 3 days, 4 days. We should be arriving. I said, yes, 8 days from now. Well, you said it was only 3 or 4 days. I said, but I didn't know you walked so slow. And we finally arrive. And he lives with the Motilons. He was there for a month. Some anthropologists come for 3 or 4 days. He stayed a whole month. And he invited the Lord to come into his heart because of the Motilon witness. I was to come to Sweden, but I said, no, I'm not going. I was invited by the publisher. And Andres Kuhn said, well, I'm going back to Sweden. I'll tell the publishers that we'll be there. Tough luck. He went back, spoke to Jean Malm and Olsen, the publisher at Libris. And he accepted a tour to speak in evangelical churches about the missionary Bruce Olsen, his Motilon experience. And he witnessed the resurrection of Jesus among the tribes, and Lars Persson recanted his accusations against the mission enterprise. Lars Persson says, well, at least there's one tribal people who have benefited from contact in dialogue with the West and the Christian message. I was to go to New York for translation consultation on the New Testament, and I was very proud that it was contextualized. That is to say, understandable in the Motilon language and culture. And Eugene Nida said, but we don't call that a translation. That's an interpretation of theological points of view. We can't publish that. That was 40 years ago. Now they're doing what I did 40 years ago, but in English language. The paraphrased New Testament in English. Mm-hmm. The amplified New Testament in English. The first Motilon will leave the jungles to study in gymnasium in the city. His name is Taksarara. Imagine he squeezed his toes together in tennis shoes, stuffed them in. He couldn't walk. It was like that. So I figured if I cut a hole in the tennis shoe, they'd take out his big toe. It could sustain him and he could walk all right. And it worked. He counts to 3, but he can read and write in his own language. In high school, the first year, it was a tragedy. Terrible marks. The second year, he learned Spanish. The third year, he's an academic achiever. Fourth year, he's on the dean's list of academians. We have 6 years of high school in Colombia. And the last year, you write a term paper in English to show that you are polyglot. Polyglot means several languages. So he has Motilon, Spanish, and now English. This is what his term paper sounds like. Colombians call us Motilons because we have short hair. In Spanish, motilar is to get a haircut. Motilon is someone with short hair. We call ourselves Bari, that means the people. In the jungles, we walk on a new trail of life's experience. We grow corn, we grow rice, we grow beans. We stop epidemics with preventative medical procedures, and we walk in the footsteps of Jesus to have peace with our Creator. We have good chieftains, good leaders. In the city, there are many trails, and on every trail, sidewalks and streets, there's a politician who says, I have truth, follow me. But everybody is hungry. A full stomach is a happy heart. No one is happy in the cities. In the jungles, we have new foods, new harvests, good leaders. Where is it most logical for us to live? So the director of the high school is disturbed over his observation. And the director of the high school asks him in a general assembly, if you don't have money and if you don't build monuments, what's the value of life? Dr. Sarara said, the character of each individual is the value of life. He's graduated magna cum laude in law from St. Thomas University, not just any school of law. I would speak to Parliament in Bogota, and they called me a hero because I was a Scandinavian-American who lived with Indians, fluent in the Indian languages, and I'm proud that they loved me. But when I'd touched the subject of legislation to protect tribal territories, it was always rejected, until Dr. Sarara came with me, and I said, I can't speak because I have laryngitis, but Dr. Sarara will address you. They said, but he's an Indian. And Indians are an embarrassment. They don't dress like us. They don't act like us. They don't think as we do. They're minorities in the jungles. Ah, but he's an Indian, graduated magna cum laude in law. It's one thing to graduate. It's another thing to high honors. He spoke to them in perfect Spanish. He said, when I was a child, my parents and family, tribal members, would ambush oil company commissions. And in the ambush, they would run away, dropping their metal helmets and their machetes. Land sellers would run away, and we would harvest the trophies of war, cooking utensils, machetes and axes and hard helmets. The children, we would run and harvest these trophies of war. Then I learned to write in my own language. Then I learned to write poetry that my parents would recite to me. Then I went to high school in Bucaramanga and graduated as a lawyer from St. Thomas University. Now I've come to address Congress. Would you deny the territories that God entrusted to my peoples? We need legislation to protect our territories. And it was accepted. Not the missionary litigating the cause of the Indians, but an Indian with tools of the Western world defending his people and his territories. Well, 1 minute before two. So we can go on afterwards.
Maybe some of you need to go. I mean, please free to do it, but also please free to stay if you want to. So can we open up for 10 more questions?
Yes, yes. I would like to make another comment, you said, yes, I could, yes, and then open up to questions.
Okay, good. Just see, some people need to leave because there's my Kabbalah class.
Sure.
Vi sa aldrig att vi skulle göra allt på engelska, men jag hoppas att jag fungerar bra. Ja. Jag hade ju föredragit spanska, men det är kanske bland
Yo también prefiero español. Idioma de Dios. Después de portugués.
We say in Brazil that it's okay that we speak Spanish in heaven, but God will continue to be a Brazilian. Okay, please, your comment, and then we have some time for questions.
Okay. So I think it's important, do we? Did I do something to the microphone? Maybe it doesn't have battery any longer. So I can talk louder. It's your problem, not mine. I don't think it looks like it's off. I think the battery's gone.
Probably, yes. Batteriet är slut igen.
Ja, I think the battery.
Yeah.
No light.
When do you call these?
So I'm trying to show you that the spiritual message that the Motilon received through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit brought peace into their hearts, filled the vacuum of their separation from God, and gave meaning to life and to their community. But Lars Pearson observes, well, if the Motilones lived at peace amongst themselves, did not have drugs or intoxicating beverages, did not steal and make war amongst themselves, why the Christian message? And as a missionary church, so often we want to preach against sin, but the Indians don't sin as we do. So some Westerners think, well, we'll teach them to sin so we can save them from sin. We bring them in the dialogue with the West to make them Westerners and then redeem them from the shortcomings and hang-ups of the West. Brethren, that's not logical. It should never be done. What are the changes, Lars Pearson asks Andres Kuhn, what are the changes in the Motilone structure society after the confession of faith in Christ? Three dramatic changes that are total revolutionary for the Motilone people, that change their lives totally. Ah, but they don't wear Western clothes. They don't have transistor radios. They don't have anything that we have the West, yet you say there's a change in their community. We've observed it. They live at harmony. What could those changes be? Changes that anthropologists and neighbors don't observe, don't know, because they haven't lived with the Motilones. They haven't experienced life with them and their fears. The first great change is Motilones would not care for their orphans. The evil spirit that brings the death of the parent will bring death to any adopting family. So what do they do with their orphans? They're ostracized from the community to roam by themselves in the jungles, and they'll be consumed by the wild jaguar. That's really tribal harmony. Pobre Shota said, Jesus adopts us into the family of God. We must adopt our orphans back into the community. No evil spirit can destroy the adopting parents because we are the presence of Jesus in our community. Isn't that a strong conversion within the Motilone people? A readjustment of social values? Phenomenal. Care for the orphans. Secondly, they would not care for the elderly. The older people like myself, about 45 years of old age, their bodies are worn out. They go into the jungles by themselves to die. And the younger people don't care because they're a burden on their migrations. We must care for the elderly amongst us. That was a revelation that Jesus gave to them through the Holy Spirit within their community. Caring for the orphans, caring for the elderly. And thirdly, share foodstuffs. If you're a hunter and you don't follow piping turkey, you're inferior, but you won't admit it. I have turkeys, I have guatinajas, I have the hunt, but it's just for myself and my family. But Christ would teach us to share it with that person who's not as agile in the hunt. And the family that is not as agile in the hunt should receive. Christ built the bridge between the two. When there's a sick family in the community, food is not shared with them, but now it is because the compassions of Jesus Christ. Three great changes among the Motilones, and Andres Kuhn would observe this. The Motilones are grateful for the presence of Jesus. I heard George Bush one time mention, not that he's an authority, but he was president one time of the USA. Globalization is the great advancement into the 21st century, and I'm scratching my head. What is globalization? I saw it 2 months ago. A Motilone doctor who had come from the cities, he disrobed himself of Western clothes and put on a simple loincloth over his middle. He had a pair of rubber shoes on his feet because in the cities, your feet go soft. And when you're in the jungles, it's easily penetrated by a thorn. So he kept the rubber shoes on his feet, and he had a cell phone in his ear, talking. One portion of Motilone territory, there's a faint cell signal. What a contrast of who they were and who they are and the dialogue that they're coming to in the 21st century. An ethnologist was coming from the French Sorbonne University to visit a tribal people, and Rachel Domatov, of the Museum of Bogota suggested this be the Multinón tribe. And so he was connected with a colonist family who knew where there was a Multinón communal home in Sapakdana. And so he and two of his students were preparing their venture into the Multinón jungles to, in part, walk over the trail where Andres Kuhn had gone and then deviate to the further northern area to Sapakdana, where civilized people had never visited before. Excited and prepared with his backpack and his pith helmet and his khaki clothing, he persevered with a guide from the colonization Spanish-speaking person. And have to walk through the lowlands, the marshes, and up into the foothills of the Andes Mountains, and finally came into the valley of Sapakdana, and he's approaching the Multinón house when the Indians realize a visitor from the outside is coming. So they want to identify with this visitor. What do? The men pull up blue jeans over their loincloth and put on plaid shirts over their back, and the women put on blouses and sack dresses that they had acquired through trade. And when the ethnologist arrived, he was disillusioned. Indians dressed as 20th century Europeans. He said, I brought combs, perfumes, and red body paints that I'll give you, but you must be dressed as Multinón. Oh, Kamiokwa said, I like perfumes and combs and red body paint and necklaces that you brought. We'll take off our clothes to accommodate your request. But you, since you're visiting us, will also put on Multinón attire. And so he walked into the shade of the jungles and derobed, putting on a loincloth, woven for the proportions of a Multinón, not an European. And the women student took off their blouses and put on the simple apron, and they appeared from the jungle side when Kamiokpa came out of the main door of the large community house, an Instamatic Kodak camera, took a picture of an ethnologist dressed as a Multinón Indian. He was embarrassed and pulled his breeches over the loincloth that the Indians had given him. The women put on their shirts, and they worked further into the jungles to see that the Multilones had a school where they were reading and writing in their own language. He was furious. Then he saw that they had cattle that were nourishing mothers who were bearing children, milk that was helping the children, better bone structure. Then he saw that they were growing corn, rice, and beans, products not known to the tribe before. They had become globalized. Olson has ruined the Indians. He's changed their diet, he's changed their expression of values, and he left angry. So he went to the state capital in which the Multinón peoples live, but to the Spanish administration of the state capital, met with the governor and said, Olson has ruined the Indians. They have clothes, they have medical procedures, they have agriculture, they have livestock, and they started out a co-op by which they're earning money. He's ruined the Indians. And the governor said, the Multilones were dying because of epidemics decimating their population. They've stopped the epidemics through sanitary procedures. There were people going hungry at the seasonal change of wet season to dry season. They've filled the stomachs of their people. They can guard harvests for the need, for their elementary need. They are Colombians. And as a Colombian improves their lifestyle, so Colombia improves. The governor was pleased that the Multilones had schools, had livestock, animals, that they were reading and writing their language, that they have the alternative of clothing, if that's what they wish, because they're becoming more and more Colombian. That's not why they're Christian. They're Christian because Jesus lives in their heart. And Jesus reconciles them to the Creator. But they're in dialogue with the outside world. Now, how is the church among the Multinones going to mature? Should they listen to the prophecies of the echo of the cave? Should they wait for the rustling leaves of the trees to bring prophecies to them? How do you grow spiritually? Through God's Word? Through academia? Through fellowship in the congregation and sharing of the Spirit, that which Christ has shown you in Scriptures? The elders of the church understand the young people who God is calling to be a witness, perhaps in a foreign country of the world, or goals that you might have in life as brethren share you're maturing in Christ. This all comes from the Word of God and the instruction of His Holy Spirit. So we finished the translation in the New Testament. And Eugene Nida said, that's a paraphrase translation. It's not acceptable. But 40 years later, there's the paraphrase translation in English, which is acceptable. Well, our students in medicine and law also said to me, we love the translation that you did that's contextualized, but it's not academic, and it's not true to the original Koine Greek. I said, you know that for a fact? Oh, yes, we do. We're studying Greek. You need Greek in medicine. I said, this is a challenge. And yes, it is. You've got to make a better translation. I said, no, you have got to make a better translation. You have the tools. It's your responsibility. They said, let's negotiate this. Let's work together. So we finished the second translation of the Motilu New Testament, the Academian and the Paraphrased. 2 months ago, we had a large convocation among all the Motilon peoples from 52 different communities. We came together, and the elders say, we'll read from the paraphrased New Testament because we understand that. And the academic New Testament, oh, the students, they can leave our worship service and go off by themselves and read from that academic. Well, so God has blessed them with His Word, both the academic and the paraphrase, and they grow in grace. As the Holy Spirit constrains you to be a witness within your community, God's Holy Spirit constrains them to be a witness among the tribal people. We started out in one tribe, rather insignificant as to population, 5,000, but now we're in 18 different languages representing 250,000 people in the isolated areas on the Colombian-Venezuelan border and the border with Brazil and Peru. Missionaries are Motilones who are led of God's Holy Spirit. A doctor can speak 4 to 5 different languages. Their minds are not confused with trash like some of our young folks are entertained by electronic games. They are pristine minds. They understand linguistics, and they have the gift, the ability to learn other languages and work in translation of scriptures in these other languages. So we're translating now in 5 different languages, the New Testament. And by God's grace, the people grow. The community is in solidarity, and they're in dialogue with the outside world, not having become beggars. One other comment I would make. The Motilones got their cooking utensils after raiding oil company camps or in their confrontations of war against the land settlers. Now when they receive Jesus into their heart, they realize they can't kill their enemies, because Christ can be a redeemer for their enemies as well. We've disrupted their economy. How are they going to get metal axes, machetes, and cooking utensils? They got this as a product, a trophy in confrontation. So I got this idea that we can get chocolate, cocoa, which grows wild in the jungles. We can harvest it, we can ferment it, we can dry it, and then sell it on the market in Cúcuta. So we took a bushel of chocolate and sold it and made a small profit. And with this profit, able to bring cooking utensils, machetes, and axes back to the jungle. Then the cooperative begins to prosper. Today they have 10 truckloads of chocolate each month that they're sending to the market. And with these 10 truckloads, the profits that they make from their co-op, they're underwriting the expenses of their health program, 48 health centers, underwriting the expenses of their bilingual schools in the jungles. And now we'll start scholarships for university studies. 400 people have studied in university. Not one student has abandoned the jungles for preference of city life, because they've dedicated themselves to the call of Christ in their hearts, and they have an obligation with their respective communities. And the cooperative continues to prosper. Then Colombian violence comes to our frontiers. Revolution, so there can be social equality among the different classes of people. And they want the Indians to embrace this revolution. The Indians don't understand politics. They say violence engenders violence. We want nothing of war. But they are there, and drug trafficking is there as well. But the Motilones know the vacuum they had in their heart, civilized people have in our hearts as well. And their prayer is building bridges to see Christ meet the vacuum in the heart of those who have not met Him, who did not know of His resurrection. Now we could have questions if you wish.
You can do it directly in English.
You can do it in Swedish, and you can tell me in Spanish.
Or in Spanish,
yeah. First of all, thank you so much for being with us today. It's such an incredible honor for our students to be here.
I'm honored to be with you.
To us.
Thank you.
My question is: first of all, when you left for the jungle as a 17-year-old, yep. did you know that it was going to be a lifelong call to stay there all this time, or did you think? Or was that something that maybe developed over time? And also, I'm wondering, what would you say to my generation, for people that are trying to figure out what our calling in life is, and what God wants us to do, and how to find that call?
A very concerned pastor asked me, do you recommend to my young people to do with their lives what you did with yours? And I said, no, I think they should be more original. What do you mean more original? Know the Holy Spirit's instruction in each young person's life. That's more original. There's a place for each one of us on planet Earth. And it's wonderful, it would be the place that God would want to place us. But if you have good goals in life, God is with you as you're attaining these good goals. You're not being chastised because it's not uniquely what God would choose for you, but He's with you in all of life's experience. When I was first captured in the jungles, an arrow slashed through my thigh, and I prayed to God, do a miracle, because the Motinos are going to eat me alive. And I prayed for thunder and lightning so the Indians would be frightened and leave me. But nothing happened. Then I was more charismatic. I said, God, send an earthquake to shake the earth under our feet and scare the Indians away so I could escape. What innocence. Escape to what? With an arrow through my leg. But that was my prayer. No earthquake appeared. And then a great miracle appeared. It was greater than thunder and lightning. It was greater than an earthquake. God put peace in my heart that I was at the right place at the right time. That does not happen overnight, to know God's presence in your heart. That is maturity. Young people have got to surrender their lives to Jesus. Be with other young folks of the same confession who knows the resurrection of Jesus. Be concerned and active in a youth group, not in entertainment, but to search the scriptures, know your heart, and discover how you can emulate the life of Jesus. And as you grow in maturity, God will put that witness in your heart where you're to be, where you're to serve. When I went to South America, I knew I wasn't a member of a mission organization. No one wanted me at 17 years of age. I arrived in South America and heard Spanish for the first time. And these young people took me under their wings, that I related this afternoon, brought me to their boarding home. So I went to the university, learned good Spanish. I identified with the Colombian Venezuelan students. And then I heard of the Motilón Indians. Then I ventured into the jungles with the Yupas and met the Motilones. I said to the Lord, I've had enough of the jungles. Now I will go to Tel Aviv, which was my first goal in life. And the problem is, you're in the jungles captured by Indians. How do you get out? Which is the way out? So I survived 7 years. And I could share the gospel for the first time. Then I didn't want to leave. And when I left the jungles, I felt so insecure. And when I leave the embrace of the tribal peoples in South America, I feel out of place, but I can put on a tie and a suit coat and look rather decent at times. But I'm masquerading as a gentleman. My heart is among the tribal peoples. So this grows through maturity, interexchange with other Christians, and the decisions that you make in life. If you make wrong decisions, God is with you. He's not chastising you. He's supportive of you, and all situations are reconcilable. In preparation, it was a blessing that no mission organization wanted me, because I would have finished, I'm sorry to say this, Bible school in the West and university. I finished university in South America, bonded with South American people. Speak a good Colombian, Venezuelan Spanish. My contemporaries are authors, poets, politicians, businessmen, And when it was criticized that an American Scandinavian was exploiting Indians and the life and the style of Lars Persson, the editorial of the newspaper said, but he's a graduate of our university. We had no understanding that he spoke English. He's one of us. How beautiful. So I'm adopted as a son in Colombia, Venezuela, adopted by the tribal people. I've been with the tribes for 57 years, and you know, maybe I can wear them out. You know, you get tired of friends sometimes, they're always imposing. And I was bathing in the headwaters of the River Gold, the unexplored border between Colombia and Venezuela, when Bisan Dora jumped into the river alongside me and thrust his finger into the scar on my leg. Do you know who shot you? No, I don't know. I did. what's he going to do now? Drowned me? And he said, I wanted to kill you. Then he changed the history. And he said, if I had not shot you, you would have run away. That means they want me. Is that loving to be wanted somewhere? So anything that I might have lost from the Western world, I've acquired among the tribal peoples. And I, in one sense, am fulfilled, and it's wonderful that we worship God in all of life's activities, not just once a week, four times a month. Every day is worship. Other question?
Let's mention that Bruce has mentioned Lars Persson several times, an anthropologist, a Swedish anthropologist, and in this book that Anders Kuhn wrote, there are these criticism, but also what Anders find out when he visits Bruce there. So just to mention that. Yes, any question?
Yeah, I wonder, when you translate from Greek to Motoloni, how much can you change from, you know, the context?
That's the dilemma.
Yeah.
That's the dilemma. How much can you acculturize, contextualize? Let me give you an example. You saw the Motoloni's building a home. The Lord says the wise person builds his house on a firm foundation, a rock foundation. Motilones dig a hole in the jungle floor with machete and put the pole in the floor. You can't do that on a rock. Then the Motilon climbs up this pole and the pole in front of it, 30 meters apart. And the weight of both bodies, they start swaying back and forth. And when they fall towards the center, they grab hands and bind it with a vine. That's the first arch in the construction of the Motoloni home. So I'm watching them build a house, 380 arches. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 386. And the Motoloni walks behind. I said, yes, 386 arches. Uh-huh, many. But the house... Then they bring that lattice work in, the palm strips that they put on the side of the home to give a unity to the construction. What is the foundation of the Motoloni home? It's called the kayakubaina. It's a green wood from the jungles. When it dries, it's impervious to insects and to rot and to mold. So they take this kayakubaina and tie that in vertically to all the horizontal arches. That's the foundation of the Motoloni home. If you take a kayakubaina from the jungles that can rot or be penetrated by insects, the house will spring apart. So it's the wise man who used the kayakubaina, the strong wood, that's the foundation of the home. This is called contextualization. License to sin.
So that's how you translate it.
That's how I did. I said, it's the wise person who is the kayakubaina, not the rock, but that horizontal tie-in pole that makes a unit of all the individual arcs. And they said, that's wonderful. The word to adopt, you verbalize kayakubaina, that is the word to adopt. We not only have kayakubaina as the foundation of a home, but when we verbalize it, it's receiving the orphans back into our community, that which God adopted us into his family. Very strong spiritual message. There are other examples as well. Any other question? Yes?
Do the tribes send out missionaries to the cities or only to other tribes?
No, our concern is among the people who have not had contact with the outside world. once they get into the city, they're going to have a jungle more dangerous than where the jaguars live. And this is going to happen eventually. But I'm so thankful that they met Jesus first, who gave solidarity to their tribal beliefs and focus, and given them a sense of value that now they saw a computer for the first time, were intrigued with it. They pulled out the letters and hung it on their necklace, a jaguar tooth and a letter A, bear claw and a letter Y or I. Then they found the transistors inside. They break it off into pieces and it reflects different shades of blue, yellows, and greens. And they decorated this on their necklaces as well. That was my first portable computer. Then I got another portable computer, and I showed them how this works. Now we have about 150 computers in the jungles working off solar energies where doctors can consult tropical medical procedures from the Institute of Tropical Medicine in Brazil, where they can make consultations with the library in Spain of the early Spanish documents protecting traditional Indian territories. I imagine they're going to discover games and other things as well, but I hope I'm not around when that happens. But I think God gives them a sense of value. Any other question? I would like to mention something that might be helpful for some of you if you ever go to a mission field. I brought a missionary family into the jungles, and they would bring 15 bundles of materials that had to be portaged, 8 days on a trail. And I finally get them to the headwaters of a river system and allocated in an Indian home. And he unpacks his two-way radio and he calls the mission headquarters. I have arrived. Olson is here and I'm with the Indians. And the voice talks back to the radio and the Indians gather around. There are midgets inside that box. What is he telling the midgets and what are they saying to him? And the next day he goes back on the radio and they hear the midgets again. So when he went to bathe in the river with his family, they took the back of the radio off and they saw these brightly colored wires, red, green, and yellow, and the tubes and so forth, and they pulled out the wires and hung that on their necklace alongside the keys of my portable computer. And so he wouldn't know that they had gone into his radio. They stuffed vines in the back of the radio and put that piece of plastic over the vine so you couldn't see it. And he turned the radio on the next day and no midgets talked. The Indians knew there were no midgets inside there, but they didn't know what the electronics were. And so he thought, well, the only thing is to disassemble the radio, see what the problem is. And when he opened up the back of the radio, he saw the vine stuffed inside. The Indians were amazed that he knew the difference. He pulled out the vines and saw that they had decorated their necklaces with cords from his radio. He was so angry, he invented something that destroyed his relationship with the Indians. He created a door to keep them out. And the Indians knew that the door that he created was to isolate them from his things. It was so upsetting, 120 people packed up and moved away and left him alone all by himself with those 15 bundles that we had to portage to bring him into the jungles. And I took him out, all his pertinence, behind. Well, you think a door is simple. It destroyed his relationship with this tribe. In Ecuador, we made contact with tribal peoples. And then the oil companies entice the missionary to convince the Indians to leave their traditional lands so Shell Oil Company can produce the petroleum in these territories. We get confused with industry. We vaccinated our children against polio, but no one vaccinated these tribal peoples against polio. Our children are protected, and 30% of the tribal people came down with crippling polio. What's happened to our vision? What's happened to our thought? Why is it vaccinated just for us, not for them? Why is it a radio for us? We keep them out of our things. Why do mission organizations build walls around their structures, their buildings? Because other tribal peoples cling on to things that aren't theirs. What's more important, the things or relationships? Paul says in Hebrews, there's a race that's set before us. We have encumbered ourselves with weights. What do you do when you run a race? You go as light as you can go. Paul challenges us to let go of these things that have encumbered our life, look to Jesus, and persevere. Missionaries must learn to do this. You don't need a radio, two-way radio. You don't need these things. It's beneficial if it can help you. But we make landing strips into jungle areas. So we can bring the missionary in. What happens? The missionary would travel over a simple road system with the local gentry. And yes, it's uncomfortable. Sometimes you're traveling with pigs and chickens and people who smell worse than we do. Or maybe we smell worse than they do from their senses. Nevertheless, it's 6 days in the bus and you finally arrive to the tribal area you're going to. But God blesses us with an airplane and we can put in a landing strip and then we can fly from one point right into the jungle areas. And the Indians see the airplane. Well, if you can fly in and out, why can't we? Because you're not a missionary. Well, I want to be a missionary. Well, I mean, that we're here to serve you. Oh, yes, yes, yes. We want boxes with red paint on them. We want these strange things they bring into our territory. We love tin cans. They will save tin cans because they don't know how to make them. But these beautiful gourds that they carry the water and throw them away to bring the water in rusted tin cans. Because you brought that from the outside. We want to go there. You can't because you're not a missionary. It's just for us. Okay. Then the Spanish-speaking people say, you used to travel with us over that road system 6 to 7 days to come to the interior jungle area, but now you fly overhead. It must be because you have diamonds and gold and minerals that you found in the jungles, and we are looking for those as well. Then there comes the violence of insurrection. They discover there's a landing field. Then drug traffickers come. That landing strip is appropriate for us to smuggle cocaine out of jungle areas. And the Indians that the missionaries contacted will just say, we're friends who work together, and you plant a new crop. So you have Indians growing cocaine, taking them out by the landing strip that the missionary founded to bring the product out of the jungles and to the Caribbean and North America and Europe. And the Europeans accuse Colombians, you're drug traffickers, yes. But you produce the chemicals by which we produce the drugs. If you don't sell us your chemicals, we can't produce the drugs. Oh, but that's your fault. We're a free market economy. We can sell you whatever which we please. Yes, and we'll supply the cocaine that you insist that you must have. How complex this system becomes. Good intentions of a mission organization putting landing strips in supporting drug trafficking. It was not our idea in the beginning, or the mission idea, but it has happened, it is happening, and it shall continue to happen until we put things into proper priority and perspectives. Let's go unencumbered to these areas. Mission organizations have asked me at times, what would I do to prepare a missionary candidate? I can only share which has been my experience. When I graduated from the university in South America, I bonded with the educational institution. I bonded with parts of society. When I went to the jungles and was accused of exploiting diamonds and emeralds, they said, he's a graduate of our university. We know him since he was 17 years old. That was a great help for me. At one time, I would be deported from Colombia because they said I was bringing agitation in the Colombian plains, agitating the Indians to claim that which is rightfully theirs. And the president of Colombia intervened on my behalf and said, he works for me. I had a passport, it was confiscated from me, because it was dubious what was my citizenry. And I was 3 months a person without a country. And the Colombian government gave me a passport, gave me their citizenship. I don't think missionaries should surrender their citizenship, but in my case, Colombia blessed me. Gave me legalization, bonded with the people. I think mission programs could have extension studies in the field where a candidate might serve. So you can have your Bible school here and university here and finish off at a university in Caracas or some other capital city or educational center in South America or in Asia. And that last year or 2 years, you bond with the other students, you're part of their society. And they're delighted to teach you their language because they realize you have humbled yourself to learn as they. You're not an arrogant Westerner. And when you need consultation, you have people of confidence with whom you can consult. Also, I would suggest, if you're going to pioneer missionary activities, I would think the elders of the church and the mission organizations will allocate you in a new area where you do not have to build on other people's foundations. Preach the gospel that's never gone before. But understand, this might be a lifetime dedication. I was sick at one time and told I would have to leave South America because you're going to die here. Well, people die in North America, people die in Sweden, why can't I die in South America? Oh, you mean you've entertained that idea? Well, I don't know where else I'd want to die. And I hope the vultures of the horizon will consume my flesh when it's my time to pass to the other side. Other questions, or is that time up?
Maybe we need to finish here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have a lot to think on and take from here. Lessons from a life dedicated to the cause of the kingdom, to the Lord. Fantastic is that, isn't it? Our incoming principal, please, could you come and pray? Bruce, pray for us. Please. We would like to pray the blessings of God on your life. You know that you are blessed and serving the Lord. Also the Montelons there, but we'd like to do that. And Nicholas is our incoming principal here from 1st of January, finishing his doctoral studies in missiology. And I think we all had a great time here listening and learning a lot.
Thank you, our God in heaven, that you have your way with all the peoples of this earth. Everyone's created to find the path to your kingdom. And we do pray for all the things we've heard today about the people of these Montelones. And we pray for their future and that their path will hold all the way to the horizon, in having to deal more and more with modernity and the surrounding environment. We pray that you will guide them every year onwards, and that Bruce and others will be guided by your Holy Spirit afresh, not just for what has been, but for every year, every situation, and for the young leaders taking on the responsibilities. We pray that you give them wisdom and love for people around them. And we pray for safety for Bruce as he returns back. And we pray that what has been sown in our hearts today will bear fruit in his time among us. And we pray in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you so much. Meeting 10, 15 minutes or so. Yeah. Yes.
Yes, we stand here with Bruce Olsson, who just have a very uppskattad lecture here on Örebro Missionsskola. And my friend Simon are going to ask him some questions me and him have funderat på under lektionen.
This
du får väl översätta
alltså. Swenglish. A new language. Right?
New language. Good.
Well, I would like to ask you, because as a young Westerner, I sometimes struggle finding a good approach towards and missions to especially unreached people, because I've grown up in a post-colonial discourse. So could you give some advice to young people like myself on how to have a a good approach to missions without withholding colonial structures?
Well, mission in the colonial time was bringing in Western aesthetics, architecture, music, expressions in clothing, and was converting people to a Western god who is not knowledgeable of the hang-ups and shortcomings of tribal peoples in these third world countries. I wanted to share the reality I found, that God's spirit once lived in my heart when I accepted Christ as Redeemer, brought peace to my life, gave more dimension to goals in life. And it was his spirit that would draw me to South America, to tribal areas where the gospel had never gone. I would learn the language of tribal peoples. I speak 14 of their languages. And they shared the quality of life with me. At first I thought it was going to bring them great enlightenment from the West, but I found that I had no enlightenment for them. The basics, when I was naked, they clothed me. When I was hungry, they fed me. And then they taught me their language. They blessed me. Living with the Motilon tribe for 7 years, I found that they were searching for a reunion with their creator who lives beyond the horizon. They say, we look for the trail that brings us to the horizon, but the more we persevere, the further away the horizon is from us. Now as a Motilon, speaking their language, living their culture, I understand there's a hunger in their heart, as I had in my heart as a youth in Minneapolis, Minnesota, to know the peace of God in my life. They want reunion with their creator. So I was able to take Christ-type examples from their culture of a Motilon warrior who's transformed into an ant to teach the ants how to build an anthill. That's the word incarnate. I said, God is incarnate in Jesus, to walk the trail that brings you to the horizon, and then develop the death and resurrection of Christ through language and terms of their own culture. And they would receive Jesus into their hearts, not agriculture, not architecture, not the aesthetics of the Western art, but the Redeemer himself. Now there comes a dialogue with the outside world, and some of these Indian populations want to identify with Spanish-speaking settlements. That's their right as a citizen of the country, but that's not their excuse of being Christian. To be Christian is to know the resurrection of Jesus.
But would you say that it's fruitful for Westerners to go to these kinds of people, or would you rather see Colombians or Venezuelans go to, or in any continent?
I think Colombians and Venezuelans also are constrained by the Holy Spirit to witness the resurrection of Christ. But also you'll see that they are very strong Westerners of value. You can't have a church if you don't have a square building. To me, the church is the community, the people.
Mm-hmm.
Westerners in Colombia and Venezuela will say, well, we worship God on Sunday. And the Indians don't count beyond three, so they have to learn not to worship God 6 days a week and worship God only once a week or four times a month. So Colombians and Venezuelans are as confused as the people are from North America and from Europe. I think first our message is spiritual, the peace with God, our Creator. How? Then there comes the dialogue with the West, and helping the Indians and other tribal peoples and isolated communities stop epidemics, decimating the population, to preventative medical procedures, how to improve health to better agricultural products, and how to purge parasites from the bodies of children, which enhances health as well. These are beneficial things that we can share. We should not bring the technology of the Western world in competition against their traditions. Because I believe God in his sovereignty placed the Indians in the jungles and entrusted to them the protection of these territories. He isn't sending a missionary to take the territories away from them and change their aesthetics. The commission of Christ is, bear witness of my resurrection.
Finally, here in Sweden, Sweden is known to be one of the most secularized countries in the world. It's widely considered to be a mission field. As Christians here, do you think we need to find, as you told, you found the images and languages within the culture of the Motilons? Should we find those images in 21st century secularized culture, or should we try to educate them in the foundation, the church foundation that we come from?
This is your dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
I can't judge Sweden. I love Sweden. My mother's from Sweden. My father's from Norway. And when I come here, I'm awed at your gracefulness, your concern for humanity, your expression of peace, we respect this highly. When it comes to communicating the gospel, I really think that there have got to be leaders who are open and elastic to realize that God is working in the hearts of the new generation. There are new expressions and there are new ways of communication. This should be embraced by the church. Myself, I wouldn't try to convince someone to a historical confession. As an archaeologist, yes. In archaeology is the study of dead societies. Mm-hmm. And I'm afraid the revivals that came in the late 1800s, early 1900s to young people today is archaeology. You need life today, anthropology, how to express yourself in these great concepts of redemption in the language of today, within the culture of today. And I think God gives the young leaders this talent, this ability.
So what is your primal advice to us, like the students in this school, on how to communicate the gospel to our generation?
From my position, I think it's essential to learn Koine Greek, to learn and study the classics in our confession of faith. But the young people today are not sympathetic towards these confessions. They want to hear something that they understand. For example, the King James Bible in English. You read it, you ask a young person, what did this read? I have no idea. Oh, but that's the inspired translation. It's the only real translation. Nonsense. Language changes. My father taught us Norwegian from the west coast of Norway. And no one understands it when I speak it, because the language has changed so tremendously, so have concepts, so have values. So I say all power to the young people. I would go to university, I'd meet the minimal requirements of the School of Theology, and then I'd go out with the conviction that God puts in my heart to share the gospel, modern, in Swedish, that is popular among young people. You will find sin in the world. You don't sin to identify with sinners, no. You're with the people who are caught up in drugs and these variants of our social goals to share the gospel and respect their position and respect their arguments. And I think you'll find the correct language, the correct examples that will work into their heart. You know, we have the working of the Holy Spirit in the heart of each listener as well. So Christ is preparing their hearts. Now it's time to plant the seed, and the harvest will come. Is success in your endeavor to build a mammoth church? I hope not. I hope your success is to live the Christian lifestyle. Mm.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, and good luck on your continued journey. Ja, då står vi här med Martin Årsmar, missionärsbarn. Du är uppväxt i missionärsfamilj och har levt missionärslivet lite grann via dina föräldrar. Och vi har nyss lyssnat till Bruce Olsson som har berättat om sin tid som missionär. Vad tycker du om dagens föreläsning?
Vi börjar om. Jag ska titta där. Ska jag börja?
Ja, gör det.
Ja. Nej, ja, jag är uppvuxen i ett missionärshem och har bott i Afrika i 3 år. Från när jag var 3 till jag var 6. Men skillnaden är ganska stora. Även om jag inte kommer ihåg supermycket så måste man ändå se att skillnaden är att han kommer till ett ställe som är helt, ja, jag, ursäkta mitt ordval, men helt ociviliserat. Medan dit vi kom så var det var en by liksom. Det, de hade ju fortfarande mer, ja, haft mer integration med västvärlden än vad det stället där Bruce kom i Sydamerika. Så det är väl en skillnad, men man kan se likheter också såklart. Det var inte liksom high standard där vi var heller. Nu har inte jag supermycket minne, så jag bara var 6 när vi kom hem. Men utifrån vad jag fått berätta och sådär, så det är klart att det är likheter. Vi hade inte elektricitet där vi bodde. Ja, vi hade, typ sista året vi bodde där så hade vi 1 timme om dagen elektricitet, men innan så hade vi ingen el. Så att det är klart att det är annorlunda.
Hur tänker du kring det här med att kontextualisera evangeliet och inkulturation? Jag vet, du läser ju missionsvetenskap just nu. Och Bruce tog även upp det om att vissa av de liknelser som vi använder i svensk evangelietradition inte funkar i andra kulturer och att man måste...
Nej, jag tror att kontextualisering är jätteviktig till en viss gräns. Det finns en skillnad på när du drar kontexterna så långt att du börjar inkorporera andra religioner. Och ibland tycker jag att det dras åt det hållet, att man försöker så hårt hitta i olika kulturer och olika religioner likheter med kristendom, att man försöker att det blir för långt, och det här är väl den klassiska ritstriden liksom. Och det är väl någon slags gräns där man måste hitta, man måste klara av att tala ett språk som är ett kulturellt språk, men samtidigt inte gå över för långt för att få in liksom hedniska religioner till exempel, eller ja, andra religioner också.
Utifrån din erfarenhet av mission, utlandsmission, hur tänker du kring Sverige som ett missionsland och inkulturation och kontextualisering där? För att vi pratar gärna om mission som någonting som sker där borta, och att vi åker ut till alla andra länder, samtidigt som Sverige är ett av världens mest sekulära länder och kanske därför ett mer prioriterat missionsland då än länder i Sydamerika.
Det som är det svåra, och det märker jag ju själv när man försöker prata om Jesus, det är lättare att prata med folk som är negativa mot religion och mot Jesus än vad det är att prata med folk som lever där halvkristna. För det problemet som vi har, både problem och en tillgång, det är att vi är ett kristet land från början, och att vår kultur är så starkt präglad av kristen tro. Så att folk, det blir liksom, det är svårt ibland att hitta den här brännpunkten när det, och så därför och göra någon slags kontextualisering på det svenska samhället blir jättesvårt, för att vårt samhälle är ju kristet även om folk inte lever i kristet, och det är nästan svårare. Man skulle nästan önska att det vore sekulärt rakt igenom på något sätt, så att vi inte hade så här gamla fina grejer kvar, utan att det verkligen fick bli någonting nytt. För problemet, nu kommer man någon som bara, jo men det där är ju bra, så skillnaden är bara att du tror och jag inte tror liksom, och så slutar man där. Och det är svårt att hitta den där brännpunkten, och därför det är lättare med folk som är riktigt hårda liksom, och jag tycker det är roligare att prata med sådana, då kan man komma med någonting.
Har du ett kall eller sändning till att bli missionär när du är klar med dina studier här på MS?
Ja, det var en väldigt svår fråga här. Ja, jag måste lämna det öppet. Men vi får se vad som händer. Ja. Men kanske.
Efter att du hört Bruce, känner du att du varit inspirerad till, eller mer avskrämd?
Nej, avskrämd är det inte. Jag tycker det är fantastiskt. Någonstans så utmanas man, och det tycker jag är en av de sakerna som är intressant med när man hör om mission. För på ett sätt kan jag tro att mission också är en flykt. På grund av att man tänker, vi letar, som man har sett när vi som kristna pratar, och märker när vi pratar i klassen så här, hur kan vi leva som kristna där vi är? Och ett problem är att vi har så svårt att veta hur det ska gå till i praktiken. Och en flykt kan ju bli, jag har drömt om att göra som Bruce liksom. För det blir så tydligt att han lever kristet. Medan det är svårt att göra det här. Och någonstans, på ett sätt, så skulle det vara så skönt att bara säga, men jag drar någonstans där jag måste liksom förlita mig på Gud. Och där man inte har hus och hem och familj på det sättet. Familj skulle man ju ha något av med sig. Men där det blir så att man måste börja lita på Gud i allt man gör. Men på ett sätt är det en flykt också. Och därför så, någonstans så blir det så här, ska jag ge upp då? Inte försöka leva så kristet jag kan här, eller och dra? Eller ska jag försöka hitta ett sätt att leva fullt ut här på ett bra sätt? Och det tror jag är en sån kamp hos många. Så jag tror att mission inte alltid är lösningen, utan det kan vara en flykt också.
Okej, tack så mycket för din tid, Martin.
Tack.